So hello again. One more time. Hello again. That's better. Thank you. So the governor has arrived. Thank you, governor, and your team for gracing us today. I'm not going to beleaguer the time because I know you're anxious to hear the governor's remarks. But what I will say in introducing the governor and welcoming him to the stage is that the thought that resonates with me around the governor and the initiative that he's going to discuss with you today is just around commitment. And I spoke with you briefly around commitment this morning. And you can always tell a person's commitment or a group's commitment by what they're willing to share in time and resources to that commitment. And I can tell you that over the course of the last year and a half or so that I've spent more intimate time with the governor and his team, that they have definitely illustrated a commitment to workforce development, which is all of the work that we do. So I will not be lingering the time any longer, but I will have the governor come up and share with you his remarks regarding the NC Job Ready program, which the North Carolina Association of Workforce Boards has indicated its commitment and support for it. And I hope that all of you will join us in supporting that work and that effort, as I believe it will have tremendous effect for the state of North Carolina. Thank you, Governor.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Glad to be here with so many committed North Carolinians in this great facility. RTI has been such a help as we try to shape our public policy. So thank you for coming and thank you for being here. I'm grateful for my Commerce Secretary, Tony Copeland, and for Deputy Secretary Napoleon Wallace. Glad to see our new Community College President, Peter Hans, who is with us today. Glad that Kevin Trapani, who's the head of my NC Works Commission, is here. A lot of other people who are here that I work closely with, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to talk to you about our state and my mission for North Carolina. And it is simply this. I want a North Carolina where people are better educated, where they're healthier, where they have more money in their pockets, and they have the opportunities to live a more abundant and purposeful life. That's it. That is my CEO mission statement for our state. I told that to a third grade class the other day, even. I'm saying it so much. They like the more money in your pockets part of it. But it's important for us to be a prosperous state. And I believe that that mission statement can help get us there. Now, one of the challenges of being governor, or one of the great opportunities of this state, is to be the chief job recruiter. So I'm out there talking to CEOs, I'm talking to businesses, both those that are here in our state, including small businesses, and also those across the globe that we want to attract to come here. We've got a lot of good ones we're talking to right now that I feel very positive about. But the number one issue from business people that I get, the first question I get, do you have the people who can perform the jobs that I create? Do you have the trained workforce? A lot of other issues are important to companies, such as tax rates, such as quality of life, such as making sure that they can grow and thrive. But that right now is the number one challenge for businesses. You've heard it. We have the jobs. We just need the people. And you can go to most any of our major employers and see open jobs in high demand fields. What we want to do today is to talk about how we can fill those jobs. This can address the stagnant middle class salaries that are out there, because if we can get people into better paying jobs, they can be more prosperous. Now, as part of that mission that that I talked about, there is an overall strategy of improving education in general for our state. When I talk to CEOs and chambers of commerce, I tell them, please emphasize education, because you're hearing from me, you're telling me that you want better trained employees and that you want people to fill your jobs. Please support investments in our people from cradle to career. It is critical that we invest in early childhood and in pre-K. There's a reason that leaders of technology in North Carolina, CEOs, went to the legislature to talk about increasing the number of pre-K slots, because they know early childhood is critical. Making sure that we pay our teachers more. Teachers are rallying in North Carolina. I think all of us would agree that 37th in the country is not good enough for teacher pay in North Carolina. And we know how important it is to support our community colleges and our universities. You know, we were the first state in this country to open doors to higher education supported by the public. And our great universities, including our HBCUs, provide a talent pool that is diverse and that is strong and that is attracting companies all over the world. We've got to make sure that we invest in those so that people can be educated and trained. But specifically, we know we're in a race with innovation. The kinds of jobs that are out there, new ones are being created every single day. To a high school class, I went to my old high school and spoke at their graduation and told them that probably over half of the jobs that they would have the opportunity to get in their careers have not even been invented yet. So what can we do to get our population ready? I have proposed NC Job Ready. Let me tell you a little bit about how that works and how we can coordinate an effort to get our population better trained. The first thing is lowering the barriers to education and skills training. It is getting to be more and more difficult to get that four-year college degree, and that it is more expensive, particularly for middle-class families. We've got to make sure that young people are educated, that their families are educated as young as middle school, that there are so many career pathways for them in addition to a four-year college degree. There are two-year associate degrees at our community colleges. There are certifications that can put people into really good paying jobs very early in their lives. And we've got to lower the barriers so that they can know about all of these opportunities and that they can afford to get the training. The second part of it, we need input from our employers. You know the kind of skills that your employees need to work for you. So input from our employers and making sure we have more opportunities for work-based learning. Learning on the job is critical. Our NCBCE, we're working to get teachers out into the workforce so they can understand the kinds of jobs that are being created out there, and making sure that employers know that internships and apprenticeships and other forms of work-based learning are a way to get better trained employees and employees that will end up staying with them. And we need to know the kind of skills and training these employers need so that we can provide them in our community colleges, in our high schools, and in our universities. And the final part of this, the third part of NC Job Ready, is local innovation. I go all over the state. I grew up in eastern North Carolina. My mom and dad put me to work hard on the farm every summer until I went to college, taught me hard work, dedication, and that I really wanted a job with air conditioning when I grew up. And I appreciate that. And I also appreciate the fact that I learned about rural North Carolina, its challenges and its opportunities. And every part of our state is different in the kind of workforce training that they may need to provide to their workers. So we want local innovation. We want local ideas like the Furniture Academy in the High Point Hickory area, where advanced manufacturers are saying, we're making some of the best furniture in the world in a place where people might think that furniture manufacturing is dead, but it's not. It's changed significantly. And we need a higher skilled workforce. And so they pulled together with community colleges and came up with the Furniture Academy idea. And there is local innovation that is occurring all over North Carolina that can help with workforce training. So we want to encourage our NC Works Commission. We want to encourage our community colleges, high schools, and our businesses to work on NC Job Ready to access all of these potential avenues of funding for these ideas and to collaborate so that we can make them work. Now, we do need funding. And let me give you an idea that we put in our budget that we believe is a way to help kickstart this effort. You know, we have an unemployment trust fund that is paid by employers through unemployment taxes. That trust fund now is over $3 billion. There is plenty of money there to deal with a recession or a downturn in the economy. And we can have a separate debate over the adequacies of unemployment compensation benefits for people out there. And I don't want to get sidetracked on that, but we can spend some time on it. But one of our proposals is to lower that tax that businesses have right now, but also provide that tax money to go into an NC Job Ready fund to create $60 million to help us with job training. And these are the three areas that we believe that $60 million ought to be used for. First, we call this NC Grow. Scholarships. We want this money to go to help people who are trying to get trained in high demand fields at our community colleges, $30 million. We know that there are financial barriers to some people to be able to get this kind of training. This would provide the free training, and it would funnel them into fields that we need right now that we are going to identify. And I think that this will be an outstanding way to encourage that training. We have seen states across the country go to this idea of free community college, and I think it happens to be a good one. But obviously, it costs, and we have to stick our toe in the water. And one way to do it is to ensure free training for these high-demand fields, the areas where we know that there are good-paying jobs waiting for people, that we know employers need their help right now. And let's make sure that we have a last-dollar scholarship that can be administered by our great community colleges to do that. The second part of funding here is $20 million to what we call finish line grants. I met with a Western Carolina University professor the other day. He told me about a story of a successful young woman who was about to finish up at Western Carolina University. She had a job. She was working hard. She had to drive about an hour to the campus. And those of you who live in the mountains know about driving in the mountains. And she had a massive problem with her car that required a very expensive car repair. She's living on the edge. She has to have that car to continue to go to work. She told the people at Western Carolina, I can't finish this semester. I got to come back another time because I can't afford to pay the tuition. The faculty got together and said, this is ridiculous. She needs to finish her degree. And so they contributed money to a fund to help students like this who had some type of crisis in their lives, whether it be a child care problem or a medical problem or financial problem to help them get across that finish line. $20 million in finish line grants help students at our community colleges and our universities to help them get across the finish line when they have these types of emergencies where they're almost there and they can get across and get into a good paying job sooner. And then finally, we want to put $10 million into an employer training fund. Now, I go and talk to a lot of employers across the state. They like the idea of internships and apprenticeships. And we have a lot of companies that can come and give testimonials about how effective they are, how they get good employees that often are very loyal. But it's a capital investment sometimes for an employer to do that. It is a risk. And sometimes they just don't have enough prodding to take that risk. This $10 million would be used for grants to employers to help establish these kinds of programs in their work. And I think it would be particularly good for small to mid-sized businesses who don't have the kind of capital that it takes to begin the process of making sure they have a good work-based learning in place. And I think what you're going to find is that this is going to be successful and that they're going to continue it because they know that it increases their bottom line at the end of the day. I think these are smart investments in our workforce. And I would encourage you to encourage the General Assembly to look at this as a way of funding these type of opportunities to increase the quality of our workforce. It is a very pro-business effort because I continue to hear from business people that their number one need is qualified employees. Now, we also know there are a lot of other factors affecting the workforce. In fact, I just came from the Research Triangle Park, a meeting of university researchers and some from RTI that I have pulled together to help us find database, evidence-based solution to this opioid epidemic. Another thing I get from employers is getting people to pass the drug test and making sure that people are drug-free. This is a serious epidemic for our state. I've talked to a lot of moms and dads who've lost kids. I talk to people who continue to struggle with this problem. And what we have to do is to make sure they get the treatment and prevention that they need, but we need evidence-based solutions. So issues like that, issues like people who have felonies on their records, who have been in prison, trying to integrate them back into the workforce with our reentry council that we have put together, because many of them can be significantly contributing members to our workforce. It's going to be a comprehensive effort in our state, but I believe that together we can create a North Carolina that works for everyone, that we can provide good paying jobs for people and to provide our business people and employers with the quality workforce that they need for their bottom line and for their success. Thank you very much for taking the time to come here and to be a part of this effort. And I look forward to working with each and every one of you as we make North Carolina a place that works for everyone. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.